I am yet to find a state or federal capital, nor an ocean to explain the reef part.
But what it does have is millions of years of geological history, fascinating human history, delicious fruit pies, and beautiful hiking. Welcome to Capitol Reef National Park.
We're Howard and Caitlin Newstate. This year, we're traveling to 51 parks in 52 weeks. We're visiting all the U.S. national parks in the lower 48 in a special Winnebago Vista limited edition. Each week, we're sharing where to stay, what to do, and introducing you to the people doing incredible work across our national parks. Capitol Reef is the third stop in our Utah Mighty Five tour and certainly delivers on all things that make a great national park. With an interesting name that we'll definitely touch on, Capitol Reef sees about 1 million visitors each year. It encompasses a very unique area here in Utah that's about 100 miles in length, known as the Water Pocket Fold. Essentially a warp in the Earth's crust, this geological anomaly is made up of 19 different rock layers. The drive in from the west is breathtaking, and you can really start to see all those layers on display. As we mentioned, this park is about 100 miles in length, and it is super narrow. There are major sections in both the north and south that are rugged and accessible by dirt roads. But for today's episode, we'll be focusing on this section, which encompasses the park's visitor center, scenic drive, and the historic Fruita District. There's a beautiful campground here in Fruita, which is sort of an oasis in the desert. You're camped among historic fruit orchards with beautiful views of the rock formations and the Fremont River nearby. It is dry camping, but they do offer fresh water fill and a dump station. There's also plenty of dispersed camping nearby if you can't get a reservation here at Fruita Campground. And the park even has signs outside the visitor center showing alternative camping options.
Made our first stop to the visitor center, as we do. Got our map, our stamps, we got our magnet and our sticker, and look what I found. They had a whole bark ranger section, and this is an adorable Capitol Reef bark ranger bandana, and it has the emblems of several of the national parks.
Once we were all set up in our campsite, we took the short path over to the historic Gifford House, the centerpiece of the Fruita District. It's a must visit to understand some of the earlier pioneer life before this land was a national park. And this is also the spot to grab some of the famous Capitol Reef fruit pies.
It was first built in 1908 by Calvin Pendleton. It was one of the early Mormon pioneers that created this landscape, or, you know, part of the community that was here. Originally it was called Junction. We now refer to it as Fruita. He was here with his family for 8 years, and then he sold it to Jorgen Jorgensen, who was also here for another 8 years. Eventually he sold it to his son-in-law, Dewey Gifford. They, along with his wife, Nell, were here till 1969, where they raised 4 children here. They built the barn about the same time, which is also part of the historical district. So it's a good place for people to get an idea of pioneer life. They can go in, serves as a sort of a museum, as well as a place to sell goods, similar to what you'd find like a pioneer homestead. At one point, Nell would actually bake pies for her guests that would come through. What is now the scenic drive used to be the main thoroughfare for people to visit and pass this area. And occasionally she would give pies to just random passerbyers on the road. So a little bit of a historical value to that.
Nell's famous fruit pies were originally made with the fruit harvested right from these orchards here in the park. Today, they are made fresh daily by a local baker and brought in every morning, and they usually sell out by about 2 p.m. Ranger Eric tells us they go through about 38 dozen pies a day. And while the fruit from the orchards is no longer used for the pies, they are still very much maintained today.
We have this vital resource of the Fremont River, and that is the sort of the lifeblood for these orchards. We still manage orchards much in the way that those early pioneers did. There's all kinds of irrigation ditches. It's all gravity-fed system. We siphon off of the Fremont River, and we rotate which orchards get water at any particular given point. Right now, we are in between seasons. We just got done with our blooms. Usually, the early fruit availability will be late June, early July. Those are available for the public to come in, you know, sample and taste. I have not really seen a full fruit year here in the 3.5 years I've been at this park. Fingers crossed, everything looked really good this year. We had lots of good blooms. The orchard crew is very hopeful that we will have a lot of stuff available.
Capitol Reef has preserved more than the Gifford House. You can visit the historic Fruita School, where children of the pioneer families attended class. It still sits in its original place below the sandstone cliffs. And you can still see this Fruita Grade School carving from 1935.
Fruita Grade School.
Oh, that's so cool. Wow.
We learned from the audio guide that the first teacher was 12 years old and taught for quite a long time, And then there's also a box that has an audio recording here at the schoolhouse of a teacher who taught here in the 1930s, 1934 to be exact. And she had a pretty tough go. Let's just say that the kids weren't really inclined to be taught, and the schoolhouse really wasn't up to snuff, and they really didn't have great books. But she did her best, and by the end of the year, they loved her so much, they threw her a surprise party when she left.
Aw, that's really sweet.
Yeah.
My name is Janice O'Loy-Turris, and I taught here in 1934 as a brand new teacher. I received $57 a month for a seven-month contract and boarded at Ty Norder's home here in Fruta.
You can also see evidence of human life here in Capitol Reef dating back thousands of years.
If you want to see a great example of petroglyphs here in Capitol Reef, there's a really easy pull-off right off Highway 24 with petroglyph panels. There's two boardwalks where you can walk right up and get incredible views. And it's funny, at this one, everybody says the same thing once they start to see it come into focus. They're like, oh my gosh, it's a family. And then there was one big rock chunk that broke off. There used to be more of the family continuing on. Yes. This is a great stop.
After picking up some of our own fruit pies, strawberry rhubarb and apple to be exact, we headed just a short walk over to the amphitheater to join Ranger Eric for a geology talk.
Cap Reef has one of the most extensive geological rock layers of the Mighty Five. We have 19 individual layers of rock here in this park. The only one that actually has more is Arches. Arches has approximately 22. individual layers. We span here 270 million years to about 60 million years. So almost 200 million years of geological history on this planet. That's a lot of time to cover. Luckily for all of us, myself included, 30 minutes is not enough time to cover all 200 million years. So we're gonna kinda cut our base layers in half. So we're gonna talk about this section here.
So we just finished the geology program with Ranger Eric, and it was incredible to get a great foundation of what it is that you're looking at all around us.
And what I found very interesting too is that much like Guadalupe Mountains, he walked us through how this was an ocean and then it transitioned to more of like a beach. And then it was even swamp at one point. And that was just so cool to see all of those different layers and the evolution of what created what we're looking at now.
You have this swirly one here, probably an ancient nautilus, the ancient form of modern day clams and mussels.
At times, if you're driving along the highway, Highway 24, you're actually looking at all those layers sideways. That was so cool because I can't think of another spot where you actually can look at layers laid on their side. He said, as you're driving west, you're getting older, and as you're driving east, you're getting newer.
And I really like how he concluded the program too, because he said, enjoy your park today, because what you're looking at could be vastly different even 10 years, 15 years, 20 years from now, because this landscape is constantly changing, especially with how soft the Navajo sandstone is. Oh, he scraped it in his hand and bits of sand came off.
This park is always being reshaped. It is always being reworked. What we see today is not always the way this park will look.
And so what about this unique name, Capitol Reef? Well, Ranger Eric says the Capitol part came from early explorers comparing the cylindrical or dome-shaped rocks to the dome-shaped Capitol buildings across the country. And as far as the reef part,
as an early pioneer, whether it's on horseback, on foot, or on a covered wagon, you get to Capitol Reef's wall of cliffs and you're like, I don't know where to go at this point. It's basically a barrier to your travel, much like an oceanic reef is if you're on an ocean-going vessel, so you have to kind of navigate around that. Reef is a little bit more, it's not as straightforward as Capitol.
In the summertime, this program is offered daily, so make sure you check. It's right off the campground, so if you're staying at the campground, it's super convenient. It's at the amphitheater. And then they also do an evening sunset program that we're told like the topics change every day too, so it's kind of a surprise on what you'll get to learn there. But we always, always recommend these ranger programs because it's such a great way to learn before you go out and explore.
Since we were armed with all that geological knowledge, we headed out on Capitol Reef's Scenic Drive. It's an 8-mile paved road with two spur roads, Grand Wash and Capitol Gorge, that are dirt and definitely worth a detour. You can stop at various points of interest along the way and, of course, get great views of all the amazing rock layers.
Remember from one of our previous episodes how I bought that multi-pack of audio tours? Well, it's still paying dividends because Capitol Reef was in that pack. They're all pretty lighthearted. This one in particular seems to have a lot of jokes. I'm not sure why Capitol Reef is so funny, but I'm learning. What's great about the app is it uses the GPS of your phone to perfectly synchronize the audio, so that way it is talking about the thing that you are looking at right now. Caitlin.
Yeah.
This is Radioactive. Are you out of your mind? We don't go to radioactive places.
We've gone to the most radioactive place.
We have. Before we even had a YouTube channel, we visited Chernobyl in Ukraine. And let me just tell you, we lived to tell the tale. It's actually safe to do. This is not even close to as radioactive as where we were at in Chernobyl.
So what is this, Howard?
These are radium mines that apparently, according to the audio tour, never produced. I'm not really entirely sure why they even consider them to be mines. Really, what they are bat caves. And that's why they're not sealed up. They actually have grates so that way the bats can come in and out. That's a better use than apparently the amount of radium or uranium that they were able to ever mine from these mines.
And we learned that there are 19 species of bats that call Capitol Reef home. That's a lot of different types of bats.
What's up?
This plant, super cool. It's beautiful. It looks like it's sprouting out of this like cactus looking plant. And then you've got these like ball shaped flowers that are opening up.
We made it.
We did. Thanks to this handy dandy sign that says petroglyphs. You look up and here they are. We got a sun. That looks like antlers on something. What else do we have?
Pretty interesting, because in this area there are tanks, and tanks are just natural depressions that collect water. There are petroglyphs, and then there are also all these carvings from all these people that have passed through. And I can't help but remember our visit to Waco Tanks, which this is before we had a YouTube channel. I feel like this is like the theme of this episode is before we had YouTube, we visited Waco Tanks, and it's this absolutely incredible place that has the largest collection of petroglyphs and pictographs of anywhere in the country or the world, Caitlin?
I can't.
Okay, we're gonna go with country. But there are areas just like this where you can see people who have passed through, because Waco Tanks, which is just outside of El Paso, is this oasis in the desert. It's the only water to be found in a long distance. And so everyone from Native American to people on stagecoaches would stop there to refuel with water before continuing on through the desert. And it is just absolutely incredible. This is awesome. That is so much more.
And let me just tell you, it took us probably 30 minutes to actually find the Pioneer Register. A tip for you, if you're using the National Park Service app, it's a bit further down than the marker on that map. And there is a camera, that is a telltale sign, there's a camera extended from a pole because this is a highly protected area. So look for that and make sure you come just a little bit further down the canyon. One of the great things about camping inside the national parks is that we have easy access to several trailheads and you can walk a lot of places. And we're getting ready to walk over to the Fremont River Trail. And I'm very excited slash nervous because the reviews of this are quite mixed. And I think we're gonna get some cardio in because there is a very steep climb at the end, but then we're treated to incredible views. And part of the Fremont River Trail is dog friendly. There's an area with a gate and pets aren't allowed past that, but you can walk them on the whole other length of the trail. Starting to climb. Wow. So just a little bit past that gate, all of a sudden it's like, bam, you're starting to climb. But it's already so incredibly beautiful. I can see how some people would be a little bit scared of this because it is along a ridgeline and there is a drop off, but I will say the trail is wide enough. Like, I'm afraid of heights and I don't feel scared right now at all. And even if you just make it a little bit past the gate and climb up just a little bit, I think it's definitely worth it. All right, we made it to the first overlook. It's definitely a steep climb, but I think we've done much worse. And the views just get better and better as you go. And if you come this way, you can see it's actually raining over in Torrey right now. And then this way, I can see the rest of the trail up to the panoramic viewpoint. So we're gonna do it and finish this trail strong. Right, Howard?
Absolutely. Yes. Okay, you ready?
Yeah, let's go. What do you think?
Wow. Well, I think the guy in the blue shirt, I think that's the top. But still, this is beautiful.
Wow.
Man,
There's views in like every direction. This is just so remarkable.
Guys, this is a must-do trail. You're putting in some work, but it's really not that tough.
No. So from the campground, it's about 1.5 miles to get here. So the actual trail itself is maybe like 1.25 miles. But yeah, you're ascending, but the payoff is totally worth it.
Yeah, we've taken lots of breaks and like I don't feel super winded at all. No. It's great. Home stretch. Is this the final climb?
Final countdown.
Got some pep in my step. Oh my gosh. Amazing.
See Fruta? I can see our house. You can definitely see canyons.
So beautiful.
This is a great spot.
We're the only ones up here right now. So the Mighty Five is epic and legendary. Everybody talks about Utah's amazing national parks. And something that we have now learned from doing all of these is that they're all so incredibly different. And especially with Zion, Bryce Canyon, and Capitol Reef so close together, like it's amazing because they really are vastly different. You find different geological features and you go from steep canyon walls to the hoodoos. And here you've got all the amazing rock formations. It's definitely worth doing a road trip to hit all of them if you can.
Well, we had plans to do another hike and take you along, but I somehow hurt my back, and so I'm listening to my body and taking it easy. So we decided to take the pups on a little walk, and we got some delicious tortas in town. It was so good. And then we walked over here to the mail tree, and this is actually where the community members of the Fruta District would come and collect their mail. How's that for a post office? On our next episode, it's Park 4 of Utah's Mighty Five, the fan favorite Arches National Park. With more natural arch formations than anywhere else on the planet, it's a must-visit park, and you won't want to miss this episode. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next week.